Atlantic City Racecourse in the Caesars International, defending race champion Sandpit versus Eclipse Award winner Northern Spur to see who will become the undisputed leader in the heavyweight turf division. It's a race everyone has been waiting for, even the rulers of Caesars Empire. Thrifty Car Rental, racing across America, presented by Visa. 1996 marks the start of the second half century of racing here at Atlantic City Racecourse. And this year's Caesars International may go down as one of their very best turf races ever. And hello again, everyone. I'm Chris Lincoln. Welcome to Atlantic City. And for Caesars, the first gaming corporation to sponsor a Grade 1 turf race in this country, well, they have dreamed of an event like this. Now, that's not to say the first six runnings of the Caesars International haven't been pretty smashing as well. Steinlin winning in 1990, the inaugural. He was the turf champion that year. In 1992, Sky Classic came from Canada, went on to another Eclipse Award. The last three runnings have showcased turf superstars like Star of Cozine, the 1994 winner, Lure, in the Claiborne Orange Silks, winning that year, and back to defend his title, the Brazilian champion, Sandpit. Here are the conditions for the seventh running, then, of the Caesars International. $500,000 in the purse. The distance, 1 mile and 3/16 on this historic mile turf course, three-year-olds and up, and it is Grade 1. And this is the start of the East-West Caesars Challenge, July 21st at Hollywood Park, the Caesars Palace Turf Championship for $700,000. Caesars adds bonus money to mean anybody who sweeps it gets $1 million. The weather, well, we're underway with summer here down in Atlantic City, and it couldn't be a nicer day. Nice breeze, mid-70s, cloudy, and a firm turf course. But now to set this outstanding field, let's go behind the grandstand to the paddock, my colleagues, Bob Neumeier and Caton Brader.
Well, before we talk about the field in this race, a remarkable turn of events. You know the old story of Broadway when the understudy waits all those months and years to get their shot as the lead performer. Well, believe it or not, that's the case here at Atlantic City, Caton, where four of the lesser-known riders will be pressed into service because a helicopter that was scheduled to carry four top New York riders has not left Belmont Park. We don't know the reason why. There are thunderstorms in the area, but four of those lesser-known riders are going to get the chance of a lifetime.
And even without the intrigue of the rider situation, this field has vast scope in terms of their accomplishment as well as their success stories. And in the field, no less than three-quarters of the starters have captured Grade 1 events and, in fact, have won 11 Grade 1 victories over the past 2 years. We have two national champions, and we have five horses who have earnings of $1 million or more. And even the connections have experience in Grade 1 races. One owner's been winning Grade 1s for over 50 years.
This is a terrific lineup of eight horses set to go on the grass here at Atlantic City. Let us run down the field for you now. We begin with the defending champion, that is Sandpit. He is the co-high weight at 122 pounds with Corey Nakatani. Pat Day, originally set to ride Lasigny. Tyrone Carter, the leading rider here at Atlantic City, is on Lasigny. Jorge Chavez, originally set to ride Diplomatic Jet. It'll now be ridden by Dale Lynch, another local. Mecki is okay with David Penna. Kevin Whiteley substitutes for Robbie Davis aboard number five, Op Smile. Chris McCarron is in from the West Coast, not on that ill-fated chopper. He's in with 122 pounds on the co-favorite Northern Spur, the winner of the Breeders' Cup Turf. Charles Lopez is on number seven, Polaris Star. He's a big long shot. And Felix Ortiz is another lesser light who will deputize for Eddie Maple aboard Stretch Runner Awad. This is the opportunity of a lifetime. I don't think a lot of these guys have ever ridden for this kind of money, $500,000, due to that chopper mishap in New York.
No question about it. And in terms of Grade 1 status, this race is extremely important for a couple of these horses as well, who have accomplishments in the past but need to get back to the Grade 1 winner circle. Lasigny, for example, hasn't been heard from since last October when he captured the Rothmans International at Woodbine. Now, winning a Grade 1 event off an 8-month layoff is not easy with any jockey, but no trainer better to do it these days than Billy Mott. Then there's Awad, winner of last year's Arlington Million over Sandpit. Regarded as one of the top in his division last year, Awad has had his frustrations lately, just missing against the top in California. But trainer David Donk has been very patient. He had hoped to have Eddie Maple, a jockey who knows his horse and rode him to victory in the Million. But even with Felix Ortiz, a good late punch is always dangerous.
You think they were scrambling around the betting windows here at Atlantic City? You should see him in the jocks from a couple of minutes ago, almost getting into fist fights over a chance to ride some of these top horses today at Arlington, I should say at Atlantic City. Chris?
Bob, I'm just glad to tell you there are no changes on the announcing crew. Not yet, anyway. We're glad you joined us for the Caesars International, live from Atlantic City. Thrifty Car Rental, racing across America, is brought to you by Thrifty Car Rental, historically known for low rates. By Visa, it's everywhere you want to be. Budweiser, official sponsor of the 1996 Olympic Summer Games. This Bud's for you. And by Wittenauer Watches, the perfect balance of hand craftsmanship and advanced technology. Wittenauer, the watchmaker's watch. Thrifty Car Rental, racing across America. Presented by Visa. Well, we welcome you back to our coverage here in Atlantic City, but first, bonus race coverage coming your way from Chicago, the Chicago Breeders' Cup, part of the Breeders' Cup National Stakes Series. That's 48 races, or 85 races rather, 48 tracks across the U.S. and Canada, and money from the Breeders' Cup Limited and the tracks, $12.7 million total throughout the year. Now to set the race up again, Bob and Kate.
I think what strikes me about this race is that of the eight fillies and mares that will travel seven furlongs, six of them in their last race come from six different racetracks, two countries, as far north as Toronto at Woodbine, as far east as Belmont, and as far west as Golden Gate and Hollywood Park.
And we have some nice speedy type fillies going 7/8 of a mile. There were three in the field that were locally based. From the rail, we had one of those local horses, but the conditions were good for a sprint race at 7/8 of a mile. $150,000, grade three event for three-year-olds and up. And Dixieland Gold racing for Arthur Appleton with Hall of Famer George Velasquez on board has the rail and a victory under her belt. Northern Relation was a closer long shot, but also based at Arlington. The three Rhapsodic shipped in from Hollywood Park. And the four Bunberg had a lot of speed. Mickey Walls aboard that one for Knob Hill Stable, a winner, and Toronto. The five Edmund Gons I Got Rhythm was the favorite for Bobby Frankel's. Had a lot of success shipping in from California to Chicago. Lots of talc. A Stalker from New York. And the seven Morris Code came in from Kentucky on the outside. Bailey's Blaze for Mike Stidham with Herberto Rivera Jr. rounded out the field.
So $150,000, fillies and mares, seven furlongs. This race contested earlier at Arlington International Racecourse. Now for the call, the distinctive voice of Michael Rona.
Bunbeg seemed to go down shortly after the start. A very awkward beginning for the Canadian filly, but she picks herself up, gets balanced, and zooms forward between horses to head them off. At the end of the furlong, Bunbeg showing blistering pace to lead by more than a length. Morris Code second, outside I Got Rhythm. A length and a half, lots of talc in between horses. Bailey's Blaze trapped wide, Rhapsodic on the fence, four lengths from the speed. Two further back, Dixieland Gold in company with Northern Relation. They're covered by seven. Bunbeg to the half mile by one length, Morris Code. I Got Rhythm third. Lots of talc striding up three wide. Rhapsodic on the inside, now just two and a half from the leaders. Bailey's Blaze trapped extremely wide in the run around the turn. Northern Relation two and a half lengths away, and George Velasquez has pulled up Dixieland Gold. Dixieland Gold out of the race at the 5/16. Bunbeg still in charge. About three quarters to Morris Code. Rhapsodic hunting for room on the inside. There might be a split coming if she's good enough. I Got Rhythm is in behind them in the red and white corded cap. Needs to do better. Further back, lots of talc. Bailey's Blaze at the eighth pole. Bunbeg taken on by Morris Code, but Bunbeg fighting on resiliently. Still the leader. Getting away. She's got it won. Bunbeg more than a length to Morris Code, followed by I Got Rhythm. But as they go to the wire, Bunbeg for Mickey Walls wins brilliantly. Morris Code second. Rhapsodic third, just in front of I Got Rhythm.
Very impressive considering that Bunbeg actually stumbled out of the gate, and for shrewd Toronto-based trainer Phil England, a juicy 31-40 to win in a wire-to-wire score. The key here, Caton, leisurely fractions in my book of 46-2 and 111. These fillies normally can travel early on faster than that.
Yeah, when you pick up the action at the top of the stretch, they were running pretty much the way they broke from the starting gate. And a leisurely first fraction of 22-3 allowed Mickey Walls to have more than enough horse left to carry her to the wire. And nice run from the second place horse, Morris Code, but really not enough.
And the disappointment here was I Got Rhythm, who was Bobby Frankel's charge in from the West Coast with Russell Bays at even money. No factor at all during the race, off the board fourth.
There was one note in the race. You may have heard that Dixieland Gold was pulled up during the running. A report from a veterinarian, Dr. Gary Norwood, tells us that this filly suffered a bowed tendon, not life-threatening, but possibly career-ending. But she was taken off the track by ambulance as a precautionary measure.
Thank you, folks, and a reminder that the Breeders' Cup National Stakes program comes right here to Atlantic City next Friday with a $100,000 7-furlong sprint. And when we come back, we'll take a closer look at our two champions, Northern Spur and Sandpit. Opened in 1946. This race actually started as the United Nations Handicap in 1953. And let's give you a quick look at the current odds here at the track for the 1996 Caesars International Sandpit. The favorite at 2, Lasigny at 7, Diplomatic Jet 9, Mecki at 11-1. Is Ops Smile at 32, Northern Spur 8-5 right now, Polaris Star at 60, and Awad listed at 4-1. You can bet the handicappers are scrambling. As you know, there are 4 jockey changes. It was bad weather in New York. That's why the helicopter could not fly to bring the jocks down here. Well, let's take a closer look now at the race favorites today. One is our North American champion, Northern Spur. The other, the champion from Brazil, Sandpit. Just like Caesars, to bring champions back together. In 1995, Sandpit swept the Caesars East-West Challenge, finished first or second in 7 of 9 races, earned over $1.3 million, and was not named the Turf Champion. That Eclipse Award went to his rival Northern Spur, with just 4 starts and only 2 victories. But one was over Sandpit in the Oak Tree Invitational, and the other was in the Breeders' Cup Turf, where Sandpit took a pass.
You know, with a horse from South America that's not eligible, nor his sire, you're looking at a big ticket. You're looking at $400,000 to run for $950 to the winner. And that's a bad bet from any angle that you look at it. And as good a sportsman as we like to think we are, money is dear to us, so we have to be careful. But, you know, but a great horse should overcome that. And it's, and you know, we felt we had the best horse last year, but I'm sure every year there's people that feel like that, so we'd rather not get into that too much.
Since that Breeders' Cup triumph, Northern Spur has only an allowance win to his credit in 3 starts and a loss to Sandpit.
He has dropped off a little bit, lost a little bit of his charisma, but I think he can come back because he's a classy horse around the barn, and he gives you the impression, not on the track in the afternoon, but around the barn in the morning, he has a lot of class.
And so does Sandpit. After not winning since last July's Caesars, and then missing 4 months with a splint injury, he came back in his last race and beat Northern Spur by 3.5 lengths.
I'd say that Sandpit's in as good a shape as he was then or the year before. He's a very healthy horse. Very happy, and he does well. So I think he's in as good a shape as he's ever been.
Both Mandela and McAnally know that racing rivalries like this are important for the sport.
I think it's really good for racing. Hopefully, they'll bring out a lot of fans and bring a lot of attention over either on the media or in person.
Well, it's good for racing. It's not good for me or McAnally. It'd be better if one of us stayed home, but that's what racing's about, to see who's got the better horse, at least on Saturday. And we're here to give it the best we can.
And in a postscript, Mandela doesn't seem the least bit concerned that Sandpit is now age 7.
I'm 45, and I won it last year at 44, so I don't see the problem.
All right, Dick, and we're ready to go to another 45-year-old of our own, Bob Neumeier.
Actually, Chris, 39, just like Jack Benny. Thank you very much. Joining me here is another old-timer, quote-unquote, Chris McCarron. Before we talk about Northern Spur, the helicopter did not make it because of the thunderstorms in the area, which means we have four local riders from Atlantic City. You're used to riding against Pat Day and Chavez and Maple et al. Does this cause you any consternation, nervousness, change your strategy at all because of these late rider switches?
No, it doesn't change my strategy any. It doesn't give me any consternation, but I think it's a wonderful opportunity for the guys that have picked these horses up. This is a big race, and it's an opportunity of a lifetime for them.
All right, you're up there, the board, as the favorite. Let's go back to Hollywood Park, a race a lot of people are talking about. You lost to Sandpit that day. You were 12 lengths back. Unusual position for a horse that presses the pace. How come?
Well, Bob, the only thing I can put my finger on is that you're familiar with the bounce theory, right? I had a feeling he might have bounced because he ran such a strong effort the first time back. He ran a mile and 16th and 39 and 4, which is flying. And I think that he's a horse that does better when, he's got a little bit more time between his races and so forth. But he ran well. He persevered. He came on to be second. But it was a dull second for him. And I'm hoping that he bounces back to his true form.
And that's Sandpit crossing the line on top. So the obvious question is, are you on the engine out of the gate today? There doesn't appear to be a lot of early speed in this race, Chris. A lot of these horses like to come off it. Are you going to try to play a little chess and checkers with Mr. Nakatani aboard Sandpit?
Well, I'm going to put some run on his mind when he leaves there. He's a horse that's got good natural speed, and he surprised me when he dropped back. I didn't take him back last time. He just fell back. I don't know why he did that. It's the first time he's ever really done that. But in the Oak Tree Invitational, I kind of got him running, leaving there a little bit, and he laid second to Sandpit and beat him that day. So we'll try to employ the same strategy.
All right, he's up there at 9-5 on the favorite. That's Chris McCarron. Chris?
Couple gentlemen from the Empire of Caesars have joined us. Rich Rose, the Caesars World President of the Sports, and a good friend, Vinny Miliolo, who is, of course, the director of the Racing Sports Book at Caesars Palace Las Vegas. First, Rich, again, this event shows clearly casinos and horse racing can really get along.
No question about it, Chris. We're very fortunate to have Bob Levy and Jim Murphy at Atlantic City Racecourse, D. Hubbard, Rick Bedecker, everybody at Hollywood Park, as our partners. You've got to be able to coexist. We're all in the entertainment business, and the bottom line is we've got to put something together that the fans will come out and see. Certainly the casino benefits. We get the tremendous exposure for the race. We get activity in our race books, and the tracks get a tremendous event that, you know, fortunately the people at Winter Communications and ESPN are putting on television, and the fans are the bottom line winners.
Benny, this gets it underway, Caesars Summer of Racing.
That's right, Chris. And, of course, along with our two races this year, we're happy to be joining, again, the Daily Racing Forum in our 1996 sponsorship of the 2020 Tour, where 20 racetracks and Caesars properties are visited in 20 days to raise money this year for the Shoemaker Foundation, which will benefit families involved in racing who have come upon difficult times. So, once again, everyone benefits. Casinos and gaming get together, and the fans enjoy a great, great entertainment product.
And we'll look forward to capping it all off July 8th at Caesars Palace with a big auction there. Let's take a look at the Visa three-year-old championship points right now. No changes since the Belmont editor's note on top at 33, but Skipaway could take the lead should he win the Ohio Derby tomorrow. We'll be back with more of our coverage of the Caesars International as the horses are heading for the paddock. Thrifty Car Rental, Racing Across America, presented by Visa. Glad to have us back with us on a big day of racing in Atlantic City, but what a big day we'll have a week from Sunday. It is the International Racing Doubleheader, the Budweiser Irish Derby from the Curra in County Kildare, and then live the Hollywood Gold Cup $1 million race from Hollywood Park. That's a week from Sunday, June 30th. Now for more on our event, over to Kate and Brader.
Chris, at the age of 98, owner Fred Hooper, who has diplomatic jet in today's Caesars International, knows a lot about the secret of youth. He also knows a lot about horses. And remember, he saddled and won his first Kentucky Derby in 1945 with Hoop Jr., his very first horse. Now, Fred Hooper has been involved in racing for more than 50 years, but he finds the secret of youth to be in his heart, in his work, and in his horses. Diplomatic Jet will never be that second Kentucky Derby winner his owner dreams of. But the horses win this month in the Early Times Manhattan at Belmont Park, and his presence today in the Caesars highlights a 50-year roller coaster ride in racing for Fred Hooper, a man soft around the edges, but hickory inside.
I've been accused of changing trainers a lot, but As long as I own the horse, I'm going to have something to say about it.
From the beginning, he has named his horses Four and treated them like his children. His longtime trainer, Jimmy Piku, believes results for Hooper speak louder than his words.
Oh, it's been a pleasure for 29 years. This is our 29th year, and he's still as sharp as ever and checks me out on things every once in a while and just to keep me on my toes.
If he is tough, he has earned it. The near centurion has also earned two national championships, countless civic and industry honors, and a special Eclipse Award of Merit. Still, the greatest satisfaction comes from a lifetime of breeding his own runners and buying from outside his own. Well, that would be like turning his back on family.
Why do you have children instead of buying a child? Put it like that. I just like to have my own decision and own way about horses. And 38 years building roads and airports, and I started out without anything, but I built a 24-mile job the first I ever built them. So after I got going good, well, I had a lot of people want to join Hooper Construction Company, but I wasn't interested. I started out by myself, and that's the way I continued for 38 years.
And that way, the Hooper way, has earned him the respect and admiration of many, and the wrath of a few, which is okay with Fred Hooper.
I'm well known east, west, north, and now south in the race business, so I think I have a lot of friends that are pulling for me. Of course, all of them are not.
You know, Fred Hooper can be very hard on his jockeys as well as his trainers, but in an interesting twist of fate, his pickup jockey today, Dale Lynch, cut his teeth on Hooper Farm when he first started out some 15 years ago. Chris?
Thank you, Caden. Atlantic City Racecourse recognized another racing legend this afternoon. Good friend of ours, the executive columnist of the Daily Racing Form, Joe Hirsch, was in the winner's circle here at Atlantic City Racecourse to receive a special presentation from the folks at the racetrack. Jim Murphy, their president, chief operating officer, making the presentation to Mr. Joe Hirsch. Also, Maureen Gallagher, their director of public relations. No one more deserving than Joe Hirsch. The horses are on their way out. Before the post parade, let's go back to Bob.
David Donk is with us. He's the trainer of the third choice on the board, Awad. Felix Ortiz deputizes for Eddie Maple. Have you ever met this man? Do you know anything about him?
No, I haven't. I just met him in the paddock now. I mean, I don't know what happened, but I'm certainly too upset to say too much right now.
What did you tell Felix about Awad and your plans for his run today?
Well, everyone knows he's a one-run horse. I hope he gets him back, that he relaxes, get him clear, and, you know, we got to get lucky. I think it's the two-horse race now. There's no question. Nakatani, McCarron. But I think they've got to worry about each other. And with the little rain, the course is a little bit soft. Who knows? Stranger things have happened.
All right, David Dunk, who trains Awad. Chris, how about the post parade?
Well, as the horses walk by me, there are big smiles on some new riders. We'll tell you about it. Sandpit, the one horse, back to defend his Caesars title. He'll attempt to become the fifth two-time winner of this race. His regular rider, Corey Nakatani, is on board. Sandpit, the defending champion. The two is Le Signe, a millionaire from Bill Mott's barn who won his last two starts, but that was 8 months ago. Last win, the grade one Rothmans in Canada. Tyrone Carter substitutes for the Hall of Famer Pat Day, one of those four jockeys in New York who couldn't get off the ground because of bad weather in the helicopter. The three-horse Diplomatic Jet has a new rider. He pulled off the shocking upset at 30-1 in the early times Manhattan for the popular 98-year-old owner-breeder Fred Hooper. Dale Lynch takes the reins for George Chavez. The four-horse is Mecki, comes from way back with a big late run. He won the grade one early times Turf Classic, but he's been way back the last two starts. David Penna has the ride, one of Canada's leading riders. Ops Smile, the five horse. won a stakes at Pimlico last year, only an allowance winner in seven starts this year. Robbie Davis was to ride, substituting Kevin Whitley. The sixth horse here is the champ, Northern Spur. Charles Sellers, American Turf Champion, won the Breeders' Cup Turf last fall. Chris McCarron, the Hall of Famer, 1991 winner of this race, is in the irons. The seven, Polaris Star, the Dreamers, a claimer taking a big shot, claimed two races to go for $25,000, just won a $50,000 claiming race, but this is a $500,000 grade one. Maryland's Larry Reynolds is in the irons. Awad, the eight horse, the Arlington Million winner last year, has earned over $2.1 million, a late runner who needs a pace up front. He won't have Eddie Maple back today. Felix Ortiz, fifth in the Atlantic City standings, is the rider. Half of this field with new jockeys because, again, weather problems, grounded the helicopter at Belmont Park. The New York riders could not get here today. $300,000 is the first prize, $500,000 in the purse, when we come back to run the Caesars International. Back at Atlantic City Racecourse, where the last 9 years, the winner has been either the favorite or the high weight. I know we're trying to keep track of jockeys for you, so remember, on the seven, Polaris Star, not Larry Reynolds, Chuck Lopez rides the seven, Polaris Star, and Awad, the eight horse, not Eddie Maple, it is Felix Ortiz. So remember, four different riders in this race. Well, we're trying to sort all that out. We're going to turn to Caton, though, to see if she can sort out some of our thrifty keys to this race. Caton?
Well, Chris, the keys to figuring out a race like the Caesars International involve positioning, pace, and experience, at least in the physical sense. Number one, closers need strong pace like Awad and Mackey. They have to have a pace to run at. If Northern Spur, Sandpit, or Diplomatic Jet don't hook up at the top, it's going to be tough. Number two, speedier horses like Sandpit have a definite advantage on the inside where they can relax and save ground, dictate the pace of the race. Northern Spur out there in the middle could have a hard time if he has to be pushed early. And finally, good news for you, Chris. Youth is not a benefit in this race. Since the race was renamed in 1990, no winner has been less than 5 years of age.
Good to hear for us older citizens. Thank you, Caden. Let's take a look at the current odds here. The auto-toed odds at Atlantic City Racecourse with Sandpit at 2-1, Lusigny at 7, Diplomatic Jet 10, Mecki at 12. And looking closer at our field here, and of course Northern Spur getting a lot of support at 8-5. Opsmile, Polaris Star, big prices, Awad at 9-2. So a chance for Mr. Neumeyer to find some value here as we look for our Budweiser long shot for the Caesars International.
The best horse in the world is Cigar. A lot of folks think the best trainer in the world is Cigar's conditioner, Bill Mott. And he's saddling Lusigny in today's Caesars International Handicap. The rider today, Tyrone Carter, in for Pat Day. This is a horse who last ran at the Rothmans at Woodbine. He wanted a mile and a half at 126 pounds. And here is a look of that race. Pat Day was aboard that day. This was a classy field. And Lusigny came from way back to beat Mecki and hasten to add, carrying 126 that day. He's in with a feathery 117 today. And new rider Tyrone Carter. You want to take a shot with Billy Mott? Why not? Lusigny is today's Budweiser long shot.
Lusigny, the two horse at 8-1, our Budweiser long shot. Well, they're parading to the starting gate. They'll soon head over to the turf course, and we'll be back to run the sixth Caesars International. Our field for the Caesars International, still on the main track. They've not crossed over to the turf track yet. What a great history this race has. Hall of Fame trainer Mac Miller won it 6 times. Hall of Fame rider George Velasquez 4 times, as did Jose Saddles. Bill Shoemaker won it 3 times. Larry Letterman is in his 10th year of calling the races here at Atlantic City Racecourse. He's their voice, but then he's also a lot of voices. Very entertaining race caller and a man who knows this turf course well. How's it look, Larry?
Not only is this one of the top turf courses in the country, it's one of the top turf courses in the world. Not only that, it's a fresh course. They've only raced 8 days of turf racing for this year, and the rail has been out 25 feet since the meet opened. Basically, the inside 4 paths of the turf course have not been raced on since September of 1995. There'll be no bias today. They're on their own.
Bob Arm with that information. I know you're handicapping this one. How's it shape up?
have to examine the pace very, very closely in this race. And let's look at number one, Sandpit, and Corey Nakatani as the guy who can really control the action. He has the hedge, very, very important. Most of these horses in the field today are late runners. They need a lively pace to do their best stuff. But with Sandpit controlling the pace from the inside and perhaps Northern Spur challenging today, with McCarron telling us he wants to get into the race a little bit earlier, I really think that Sandpit has a huge advantage. But having said that, at 6-5, he's too small a price. So I would go shopping if I was a player here at Atlantic City today, and I'd look at a Lusigny up there at a 9-1 or a Diplomatic Jet at 13-1. I think there's some value with these horses. But I think for the fans across the country, keep your eyes on the possible chess match between Nakatani on Sandpit and McCarron on Northern Spur. Should be an interesting pace scenario. Chris?
Let's get a word from the home team here. This is a young lady, Caton Brader, of course, was the voice of Atlantic City Racing on their television show here and handicapper a year ago. So, all you've learned, how's this one shape up? What a great race.
Well, Chris, with a firm turf course, the pace can back up if you get a pace. And Dale Lynch, a local rider, is known to go to the lead. Diplomatic Jet has versatility, but he can lay very, very close. If he does, if he pushes anyone up there, it could set up for a closer. And a horse like Mackie could be coming to his own. He has never missed a beat. He is a four-year-old, a disadvantage in a race like this, but he has overcome all kinds of obstacles throughout his career. If a horse can come from off the pace, I think it would be Mackie. Sandpit on the rail has a lot of things in his favor as well.
Again, four rider changes. Not only are you watching at home, but watching up at Belmont Park is Pat Day, who was supposed to be on Lusigny, George Chavez on Diplomatic Jet, Robbie Davis was supposed to ride Op Smile, and Awad was supposed to have Eddie Maple. They didn't make it. Their helicopter grounded by weather. We're ready for the call with Larry Letterman.
Thank you very much, Chris. The field continues to load. The horse who has the flair for the dramatic, Awad, is in the gate, completing the star field of eight. And they're off in the Caesars International 96. Sandpit jumps right out there for the lead. Diplomatic Jet on the outside also forges near the front. On the outside, Northern Spur showing new tactics is going up and after the lead. And it's Northern Spur over the Atlantic City grass stage the first time with a head to the good, moving by the line the first time. Diplomatic Jet on the inside is holding second. Stalking those two out of the claiming ranks, Polaris Star. Then a top smile, going to be four and wide. Now Whitley tries to dive in. Sandpit following the tracks that led him to victory last year as they move around the clubhouse turn. They continue around the turn. Then it's a length and a half break and a ground-saving Mekki. Pace appears to be very slow. They're racing in between them is Lusigny, and three wide is Awad. First quarter in an absolutely methodical 25-3. It's even slower than that and a half of 50-1/5. They are crawling up the backstretch and on the lead slightly is Diplomatic Jet. Right at his throat is Northern Spur. Racking those two in third is Polaris Star. On the outside, it's Up Smile. Sandpit now has to get closer at the hedge. Then comes Awad, who's going to need a strong stretch kick under these slow fraction deep yeoman's work. Then comes Lusigny on the inside and two more lengths to Mekki. They went three quarters in 14-2. Pace picks up just a little. It's still very slow. And it's Diplomatic Jet clinging to a side hope. On the outside, Northern Spur has been sticking with them. They trained 3,000 miles apart and inches separate them on the turn. Here comes Up Smile. Sandpit screaming out for racing room and will try to take the edge. They're into the home stretch. The door is wide open. It's Diplomatic Jet hanging on to a perilously thin lead. Northern Spur. Here comes defending champion Sandpit up the hedge and it found the wedge of the hedge and it's deja vu all over again. Sandpit lightning strikes again. He takes the Caesars 96. Diplomatic Jet was second and Northern Spur third. He did it again. If Caesars is the name, Sandpit's the winner.
I think we just replayed the race from last year as Sandpit had the hedge, kept it, waited until the 16th pole and exploded up the inside to catch Diplomatic Jet, and Northern Spur simply could not close the ground there. And again, the story of this race, Caton, incredibly slow fractions, a half, 50-1.
At the top of this stretch, Dale Lynch had controlled the pace with Diplomatic Jet, but when we pick up the action, you will see Sandpit with a daring move by Corey Nakatani, similar to the one he had last year, on the fence in the blue and white. He has just enough horse to come up and collar Diplomatic Jet, who has been on the lead all the way, and even with the slow pace, it was hard to hang on for a horse like Diplomatic Jet moving up so boldly in class. You also see in third there Northern Spur, who had been head-and-head with Diplomatic Jet all the way, but Sandpur, when he gets the light right. He sees it and takes it and goes for it.
Sandpit wins the $300,000 of the Caesars International. And now he is the only one with a chance at the bonus and to win $1 million by taking the East-West Caesars Challenge. Just as he did in 1995, so it is in 1996. The Brazilian champion Sandpit comes back to the winner's circle of the $500,000 Caesars International. Sandpit, owned by Sierra Thoroughbreds, that's Sergio Meneses, trained by Richard Mandela, ridden by Corey Nakatani, who wins the second year in a row, the Caesars International. Bob Neumeyer with a closer look at how he did it.
This race underscores the confidence that man, Corey Nakatani, had with his horse. If you back Sandpit, he's 3 or 4 lengths out of it at 6-5 through dawdling fractions of 50-1 and 114-2, and you're saying, what are you doing, Corey? You have more speed than that. He knew exactly what he was doing. Diplomatic Jet just drifts out enough, and there's the daring Nakatani slipping through on the hedge, and then the class shows. 4 lengths out of it, 6 lengths out of it, didn't matter today to Corey Nakatani. He is the winner in convincing fashion of the Caesars International Handicap. Chris?
Congratulations again to the connections of Sandpit. What an incredible race. Take a look at the official numbers. Sandpit, who went off the favorite, 440, 320, 220. Great run by Fred Hooper's Diplomatic Jet, 940 and 340. And Charles Sellers' champion, Northern Spur, gets up for the show at 220. The exacta at 2980. The time, very slow, 155 and 3. Remember, the record is 152 of Steinlin in 1990. Well, Sandpit returns again to the winner's circle here at Atlantic City Racecourse. We'll be back to talk to the winners and to talk to the man who is the Atlantic City Racecourse, Mr. Bob Levy, when we return to Atlantic City to honor the great Sandpit. Sandpit, number one on the saddle towel, number one out of the draw on Thursday here, and number one to the finish line. Sandpit now goes in earnings over the $2.4 million marker. Let's go down to Caton Brader.
Well, Chris, he may be number two, but Dale Lynch knows this course like the back of his hand. A local rider makes good on a person you've had a lot of experience with before, Fred Hooper. Had to be a thrill of a lifetime. What kind of instructions did they give you before the race?
Well, the trainer told me, he said, try to lay in a, he thinks there's enough speed to go, and lay. I could lay in a second tier and let them go. But the way it come up, when we come out of the gate, my horse broke real sharp on the lead, and I went to take him back a little bit. And nobody went, you know, I figured the one would go up there with the six. Maybe they'd hook, and I could lay in a second tier. But the way it come up, I've ride this turf course last year and this year all the time, and I know that we were just crawling up there, you know, so I just, instead of cramping him back and getting boxed in back there, I just went ahead and let him stay up on the pace.
At this point, did you think you had the race won?
He was really moving with me very good, but he's wanting to drift just a tad with me down the lane and around the second turn, drift out with me a little bit, and I'd have liked to switch sticks and rode him a little harder down there, you know, left-handed, but that horse was coming in there, and I was trying to keep him down in there with the right-hand stick, and there's no way I can keep him down in there.
Well, close enough, not quite there, but no disgrace to finish second in a race like that. Back to you, Chris.
It is a family tradition here, the Levy's in Atlantic City Racecourse. Here is Bob Levy, chairman of the board, with a smile on his face. Have you ever had a better race than this?
Never. It was a great race, Chris. I mean, they went real slow the first part of it, as you can see, but they went the fourth quarter in 23 and something, and then they came the last 3/16 of a mile in 17 seconds, and that's awful fast.
Very European style.
Very much. Like, it looked like a European race, and I was sort of rooting for Mr. Hooper, but, you know, he ran a great race, too. All three horses ran great races, and Sandpit was far and away the best. I mean, he got through, true, but he had enough horse to go around, and he accelerated when it counted from the eighth pole home. He was the best horse, and then he had the top weight, and he deserved to be there.
Bob Levy, chairman of the board, and a great host here. We'll be back to wrap things up here from Atlantic City right after this. Read by Sheraton Atlantic City West Hotel. Minutes from the beach, boardwalk, and casinos. Shuttle service available. 213 luxury rooms, pool, and fitness center. Call 1-800-44-ROOMS. The winner's circle, a busy place right now as Sandpit returns as a 7-year-old. He did it at 6, he did it at 7, and Dick Mandela did it at 44, and he did it again at 45, didn't he, Bob?
He sure did. In from the West Coast is Dick Mandel. I got to be honest with you. I was watching your horse every step of the way, and as they were kind of crawling through the early part of it, and Corey had him back, I don't know, four or five lengths on the hedge, I said, what's going on? Did the same thoughts cross your mind, Dick, at all, honestly?
Yeah, I was a little worried. They weren't going very fast, and he just broke so relaxed. He wasn't on the bit or anything. He was just galloping around there like an old saddle horse, and once he got back where all those other riders saw where he was, I was afraid he was going to never get out, and they had him that way most of the trip, but they finally came off the rail turning for home, and Corey was just patient and confident like he always is, and it was good. It got the job done.
And the scene had changed from the Hollywood race, whereas you had the advantage on McCarron and Northern Spur. He decided to take it to you early on, and I guess that was the horse that probably you felt you had to beat turning for home.
It surely was. The whole time, it was a pretty much obvious situation that the two horses were great horses. Last year, they were champion and second champion. But I had a feeling with the way Chris's horse ran the last time that he might change his tactics this time and try to stay closer to us. So it didn't, that part I wasn't worried about when I saw him go and we were back. It kind of confused everything, which is good sometimes.
All right, what are the plans now for Sandpit?
We'll go on to the Caesars race at Hollywood Park. It's at the end of the meet in a month, and there's $1 million bonus between the two, and that couldn't sound sweeter.
That's the smile on his face, $1 million bonus. All right, Chris, back to you.
A trainer and a financier. Very good, Mr. Mandela. Let's take a look at those Wittenauer split times. The crowd was gasping here at the slow half at 50-1, 1:14-2, but look at how they came home, especially 1:55-3 off that 1:38 mile. Mark Giuliano, the president, chief operating officer of Caesars Atlantic City, made the official presentation of the trophies here, and $300,000, the first place check going to Sandpit. Kate and Bader now with another interview.
Well, jockey Corey Nakatani, it was the same place and the same scenario, but not the same time. Were you concerned early about the pace?
Well, I was concerned, but I knew going in that there really wasn't a legitimate speed horse in the race, and I just let him come out of there nice and relaxed, and he was really kind, and he just needed a spot to turn for home and have a spot to run, and I could have went inside or outside, and I just like to opt to the inside. I think it's the shortest way home, and I think that you win a lot more times. And
here is that winning move, as a matter of fact. Did you know you had that move? You knew you had the horse.
I knew I had the horse, and I thought for sure that I can get through on the rail, and I wasn't too worried about it. I know this horse, he's a game as they come, and as soon as I ask him to run, he runs, and I'm just thankful to have the opportunity to come here to Atlantic City and have a chance to ride in the Caesars International, and hopefully we can repeat as last year in the Caesars race at California, and I think it'll be a great trip.
We'll go back to you, Chris.
All the way from Rio de Janeiro, and happy to make the trip. Sergio Meneses, the owner of Sandpit. You said ESPN's been very good luck for you.
Yes, because most of his victories have been broadcasted by ESPN. So whenever ESPN promised to broadcast a race of Sandpit, my luck increases, I think.
The first thing Sergio asked me is this being seen in Brazil today? I hope so. But Sergio, what an incredible animal. At age 7, when is he ever going to stop?
Yes, I think he's like wine. He's improving in quality with the years. So if he continues the way he is at the moment, as I told you the other day at Hollywood Park, I'll keep him in training and racing, because it's fantastic to see him winning.
Sergio, last year you didn't win a title because you didn't go to the Breeders' Cup. Would you pay that big money to get to the Breeders' Cup?
I hope, even if I decide not to pay, that will not be the key factor for judgment of the people who elect the best horse of the year on the turf.
He looked like a champion. We're going to take a look at the full order finish, Sergio, and take a quick look here at Sandpit. Diplomatic Jetta ran so well. Northern Spur, the champion. Awad, the million winner. Mecki, Lasigny, Op Smile, Polaris Star, the greatest field of turf horses assembled this year, and Sandpit number one. Coming up next, right here on ESPN, it's a favorite in Brazil as well. It's Sports Center. A half-hour Sports Center is coming up next here on ESPN. Well, 1996, very similar to 1995. The colors of Sierra Thoroughbreds and Sergio Meneses to the winner's circle, with Sandpit the winner.